morning and a very warm welcome to you as you join our Sunday morning service from Holy Trinity Redhill. As you can see, I'm not in Holy Trinity Church. My name is Hannah Bacon and I'm recording this from my home in Redhill. Whether you join us Sunday morning or another time this week, whether you live locally or you live further afield, you are very welcome. And we pray that as we worship together online, that we'll be able to draw closer to God and hear from him this morning. I don't know what your week has held for you. My week has marked the end of homeschooling, yes, and the start of the summer holidays. I have three children who have been at home for a long time now. And now the challenge is to see if we can make the summer holidays a bit different to the homeschooling weeks that we've had. Maybe you've managed to get away recently, or maybe you are one of the people who has been shielding and you are looking forward to being able to see more people, maybe go out. But maybe you've been shielding and you are nervous and anxious about going out, what the future holds and how the world has changed since you maybe last stepped outside your front door. The good news is that whatever has happened this past week, as we are here together online, and whatever next week holds, that God has been with us, is with us, and will be with us. And we can take great comfort in that verse from Hebrews chapter 13, verse 8. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. In our service today, even if we are physically apart, we are still online together, and we're going to sing together, we're going to pray together, and we're going to continue to look at the story of Elisha from 2 Kings, and Jan later will be speaking to us about Elisha and the Shunamite woman as we read the next passage in 2 Kings. Let's start our service this morning, shall we, by praising together. And we're gonna sing Cornerstone, Weak Made Strong in the Saviour's Love.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but only trust in Jesus' name. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. When darkness seems to hide, come with trumpet sound. Oh, may I then in him be found, dressed in his righteousness alone, for to stand before the throne. When he shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then in him be found, dressed in his righteousness alone, for to stand before the throne.
The first line of that song we've just sung says, "My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness." And we need to say sorry to God. We need to say sorry so we can receive that forgiveness through the amazing sacrifice of Jesus on the cross. I don't know, for those of you out there who maybe know sign language or have done it with your children when they were younger, with my three, we did something called sing and sign, and it was great that they could use sign language when they couldn't quite find the right words to say or before they could even say the words. And the sign language that we use for sorry is this, sorry. And as we come to a time of saying sorry to God now, I wonder if you would like to, or encourage your children to, when we say, "Father, forgive us," just do that sign of sorry as a way of acknowledging to God that you are saying sorry to him. And my three children now are going to read some words of confession as we bring those things to God that we need to say sorry for.
God our Father, we come to you to say sorry for our sins, for turning away from you and ignoring your will for our lives. Father, forgive us, save us, and help us.
For behaving just as we wish without thinking of you, Father, forgive us, save us, and help us.
For failing you by what we do and think and say, Father, forgive us, save us, and help us.
For letting ourselves be drawn away from you by temptations in the world about us, Father, forgive us, save us, and help us.
For living as if we were ashamed to belong to your Son, Father, forgive us, save us, and help us.
May God, who loved the world so much that he sent his Son to be our Saviour, forgive us our sins and make us holy to serve him in the world, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Gracious and compassionate, slow to anger and rich in love. The Lord is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger and rich in love. The Lord is good to all. He has compassion. That's how far He has removed our transgressions from us. As far as the east is from the west, that's how far He has removed our transgressions from us. The Lord is gracious and compassionate, slow to wait. And rich in love, Lord is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger and rich in love. Lord is good to all, He has compassion.
Really pleased to be able to interview this morning Sarah Louise Schofield. Many of you will know Sarah Louise, but Sarah Louise, for those that don't know you, would you like to say a little bit about yourself and your family and your involvement at Holy Trinity?
Yeah, good morning everybody. Thanks Mick. Yeah, so we've been at Holy Trinity for 16 years. We moved to Redhill when I was pregnant with our eldest Sammy. Both Pete and I had grown up in Reigate, and we thought the number one priority would be not to go to either of the churches we grew up in. So we spent 9 months church hopping, avoiding Reigate Methodist Church and avoiding Holy Trinity. Anyway, we felt at the time that it was right to come to Holy Trinity. It was at the point where they had just started the 9:15 service, and we made that our home while the three children were small. And then when Isaac started school, we moved to the 4 o'clock service where most of our home group had been planted early on in the days. Mm-hmm. And the 4 o'clock service has been our home.
Excellent. Now, part of the reason for interviewing you is that a number of years ago, you felt God saying something to you about your ministry. Would you like to tell us a little bit more about that and where that sense of hearing God's voice has led you to?
Sure. It was actually back in 2015, and as a family and a number of other families from HT, we had gone to New Wine, which is a big Christian festival. And the Archbishop of Canterbury was our keynote speaker. I think we'd arrived late, having settled the children into their groups, and had managed seats right at the back of the huge marquee. And I remember just so clearly that towards the end of his talk, he started ministry and he said, "I believe that God is raising up new leaders for his church." And I had such a tangible feeling of tightness and butterflies in my chest that it virtually took the breath out of my lungs. And I just sat very quietly. There was a call to ministry and worship continued, and I felt completely rigid to the spot, and actually blown away that those words had spoken so directly to me. I remember hobbling back to my tent, because at the time I had broken my ankle. And I just tried to hold that call really, really lightly, because it had really genuinely come as such a shock. Mm. I opened my Bible the next morning, and the Bible reading was Isaiah 6, "Whom shall I send as a messenger to my people? You will go for us." And I said, "Lord, I will go, send me." And I needed a really tangible confirmation of the call.
Yeah.
And that really couldn't have been more tangible. So we came home, and really I spent the next many months seeking advice and counsel from close friends and past work colleagues. Mm-hmm. Actually, many of you listening are those close friends, and perhaps I can just say now, thank you so much for counseling me through those days and more recent days. And time after time, people spoke into that calling and seemed to confirm it. And gradually I recognised that actually I felt that God had been preparing me for such a call for many, many years. I remember too the worship song from Lou Fellingham and the words, "I lay aside my pride and worldly worth to serve you is the greatest thing that I should ever know." Now that obviously wasn't a specific confirmation of a call to ordination, but for me that really spoke that
sure,
the years ahead, and it has been a few years, were going to be tough and there were going to be sacrifices, but without a doubt the greatest thing that I could ever know was to be used by God in this way.
Yeah, it's interesting to hear you tell that story, because I think it's true, isn't it, that when God calls us to something, or when he's speaking to us, he confirms it in lots of different ways. So you heard it from the Archbishop and felt that it was from God, but then in reading the Bible, in talking to friends and other members of your church, God confirming it in those ways as well. That's a kind of good biblical pattern of how God speaks to us, not just in a one-off, but from a number of different ways. And that's how we discern God's voice, I guess, isn't it? So exciting times lie ahead. Tell me what comes next. Or what came next?
What came next? Well, it wasn't a clear-cut journey at all. The journey of discernment within the Church of England is a long and hard road, without a doubt. Many, many hoops to go through, many placements in churches, which really stretched my experience and understanding and value of various aspects of Anglican worship. But every aspect of the journey, I can see how God has used to help me understand the calling more. It's been really hard. I went through a selection process 3 years ago and wasn't recommended for ordination. And that was a level of rejection but that was really, really hard to understand, specifically when you feel that it's God calling you into a role, and then that wasn't recognised by assessors. However, subsequently, actually, I felt the call even stronger, and that was really, really hard to justify through the discernment process. But God has given me incredible strength, incredible grace and understanding to get back on the horse when really I was quite ready to walk away from the whole call 3 years ago. And I just felt him constantly probing and prodding and giving me the strength that I really lacked to continue. And looking back, as often is the way, you can see that the timing just wasn't right 3 years ago at all. I'm not sure if the timing's right now, to be really honest. But actually what I've learned in the last 3 years specifically is how our relationship develops with God in a journey. It's not the outcome that matters. It's the journeying with him that really has shaped and formed and will continue to do so without a doubt.
And you've since been on another selection conference and been accepted for ordination.
Absolutely, I have, yes.
So tell us just briefly what the next few months and years look like as far as you are aware.
Well, COVID allowing, I'm due to start training in September. So I'm doing a full-time two-year diploma in theology, ministry and mission based at St. Melitus College up in London. It's a context-based course. So I have 3 days of study a week and 3 days of placement. And I've just heard in the last couple of weeks that my placement's going to be at St. Luke's Reigate, which I'm hugely excited about and can't wait to work with Anita there.
Good. But we're not going to lose you from the 4 o'clock, I understand, once that returns.
Well, certainly you'll have some of the Schofield family. So we're a family of five. The two oldest children are moving into Focus, so I expect they will move into the 7 o'clock service. Pete will continue at 4 o'clock with Isaac, our youngest, as well. And although St. Luke's has a really busy Sunday program, it has two morning services, it has messy church and evening worship. I really hope that I can come and participate perhaps at the 4 or 7 occasionally. Yeah.
And we look forward to keeping up with how things are going for you. Just tell us finally, how can we pray for you and the family, particularly over the next few weeks and months?
I think primarily it's a juggling act. I've always worked part-time since I've had the children, but never full-time. So the idea of being 3 days of study and 3 days of placement and running the home and supporting three children and supporting Pete in his work and elderly parents. Yeah, and I'm a bit of an 11th hour worker, so my time management would be a really, really big number one prayer request.
Right.
Secondly, it's been a long time since I was at university, so although I've had to do a fair amount of study and assignments in the selection process, just using my brain, I just feel that my brain is a bit foggy these days. Right. And lastly, as we're praying for anybody, all our students, you know, further education, higher education is looking so different to what we expected it to look like. So I think, if I'm really honest, there's huge disappointment that I won't be going to lectures and going to seminars and having being part of formation groups in the autumn term. Yeah. So probably adding me to our prayer list with all the rest of our undergraduate and postgraduates at the moment. It's just a really, you know, we just don't know what education is going to look like.
Exactly. Sarah Royce, thank you so much for sharing something of your story. We look forward to following the journey. You've given us things to pray about for you, and I'm sure there are many members of Holy Trinity that will be doing that. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Mick.
God bless. Bye-bye.
One day, Elisha went to Shunem. And a well-to-do woman was there, who urged him to stay for a meal. so whenever he passed by, he stopped there to eat. She said to her husband,
I know that this man who often comes our way is a holy man of God. Let's make a small room on the roof and put in it a bed and a table, a chair and a lamp for him. Then he can stay there whenever he comes to us. One day, when Elisha came, he went up to his room and lay down there. He said to his servant Gehazi,
call the Shunammite.
So he called her, and she stood before him. Elisha said to him,
tell her, you have gone to all this trouble for us. Now what can be done for you? Can we speak on your behalf to the king or the commander of the army? She replied,
I have a home among my own people.
What can be done for her?
Elisha asked. Gehazi said,
she has no son, and her husband is old.
Then Elisha said,
call her.
So he called her, and she stood in the doorway.
About this time next year,
Elisha said,
you'll hold a son in your arms.
No, my lord,
she objected.
Please, man of God, don't mislead your servant.
But the woman became pregnant, and the next year, about that same time, she gave birth to a son, just as Elisha had told her.
The child grew, and one day he went out to his father, who was with the reapers. He said to his father,
my head, my head.
His father told a servant,
carry him to his mother.
After the servant had lifted him up and carried him to his mother, the boy sat on her lap until noon, and then he died. She went up and laid him on the bed of the man of God, then shut the door and went out.
She called her husband and said,
please send me one of the servants and a donkey so I can go to the man of God quickly and return.
Why go to him today?
He asked.
It's not the new moon or the Sabbath.
That's all right,
she said. She saddled the donkey and said to her servant,
lead on. Don't slow down for me unless I tell you.
So she set out and came to the man of God at Mount Carmel.
When he saw her in the distance, the man of God said to his servant Gehazi,
look, there's a Shunammite. Run to meet her and ask her, are you all right? Is your husband all right? Is your child all right?
Everything is all right,
she said.
When she reached the man of God at the mountain, she took hold of his feet. Gehazi came over to push her away, but the man of God said,
leave her alone. She is in bitter distress, but the Lord has hidden it from me and has not told me why.
Did I ask you for a son, my lord?
She said.
Didn't I tell you, don't raise my hopes? Elisha said to Gehazi,
tuck your cloak into your belt, take my staff in your hand and run. Don't greet anyone you meet, and if anyone greets you, do not answer. Lay my staff on the boy's face. But the child's mother said,
as surely as the Lord lives and as you live, I will not leave you.
So he got up and followed her.
Gehazi went on ahead and laid the staff on the boy's face, but there was no sound or response. So Gehazi went back to meet Elisha and told him,
the boy has not awakened. When Elisha reached the house, there was the boy lying dead on his couch. He went in, shut the door on the two of them, and prayed to the Lord. Then he got on the bed and lay on the boy, mouth to mouth, eyes to eyes, hands to hands. As he stretched himself out on him, the boy's body grew warm. Elisha turned away and walked back and forth in the room, and then got onto the bed and stretched out on him once more. The boy sneezed 7 times and opened his eyes.
Elisha summoned Gehazi and said,
call the Shunammite.
And he did. When she came, he said,
take your son.
She came in, fell at his feet, and bowed to the ground. Then she took her son and went out.
Good morning. If you've been following our online service in the last few weeks, you know we've been doing a sermon series on the Old Testament prophet Elisha from the book of 2 Kings. So far we've learned that Elisha was the man of God with the word of God. And last week we learned that the word of God spoken through Elisha was welcomed in the city of Jericho, but rejected in Bethel. Today we're going to look at a story that involves Elisha and a particular individual, a woman who lived in the village of Shunem. In some ways, the story is a bit like a three-act play. In Act 1, a son is given to the woman. In Act 2, the son is taken away. And in Act 3, the son is restored to life. And each act of the play can teach us something quite profound about the nature of God. But also, we need to be aware that this story touches on some very difficult, painful and sensitive issues, childlessness and the death of a child. I'm acutely aware that there may be people watching this morning for whom those issues are relevant and extremely painful. We all know there's different sorts of pain. A few years ago, I had appendicitis and I was in a huge amount of pain for a couple of days. But as soon as my appendix was taken out, the pain was gone. However, there are some types of pain that are not like that at all. They can stay with us for a lifetime. And childlessness and the death of a child can be like that. They may leave emotional scars that stay with us our whole lives till that day when we meet with Jesus and we know he'll wipe away every tear from our eyes. The Bible treats these difficult issues both sensitively and honestly. And my heartfelt prayer this morning is that this talk will come across in a way that is both honest and sensitive. With that in mind, do look at this story, do follow it in your own Bible. It's in 2 Kings 4, 8 to 37. In Act 1 of this dramatic story, a son is given. The story begins in verse 8. One day, Elisha went to Shunem, and a well-to-do woman was there who urged him to stay for a meal. So whenever he passed by, he stopped there to eat. Elisha lived in the northern part of Israel, and he often travelled from Samaria to Mount Carmel on foot, and he would stop to rest at the village of Shunem on his way to and from Mount Carmel. Shunem was just southwest of Lake Galilee on the hill of Moreh. And in Shunem, there was a well-to-do woman who generously opened up her home to Elisha and gave him a meal whenever he was passing through. We're not told her name, but we know she recognised Elisha was a holy man of God and she offered him generous hospitality. In fact, she persuaded her husband to allow her to make up a guest room for Elisha on the roof of their house, so he could stay there whenever he wanted. It was a place where Elisha could eat, sleep, and relax. It was a great blessing to him. Well, Elisha was clearly delighted with this woman's hospitality, and he called her and he said, "You've gone to all this trouble for me. Now what can be done for you?" He even offered to use his influence to speak on her behalf to the king. But she replied, "I have a home among my own people." What she meant by that was, "I have everything I need. You don't need to repay me." But Elisha didn't take no for an answer. He asked his servant Gehazi, "What can be done for her?" And Gehazi said, "She has no son, and her husband is old." Well, at that time, it wasn't uncommon for a man to marry a woman who was a lot younger than himself. But clearly there were consequences if the woman didn't have children. In an age before pensions and benefits, who would look after her in her old age if she had no children? But it would seem she'd learnt to live with that ongoing sadness. Even so, Elisha knew God wanted to give her the deepest desire of her heart. So he said to her, about this time next year, you will hold a son in your arms. She thought that was impossible, and she didn't want to raise her hopes in case it all ended in disappointment. But Elisha knew God wanted to bless this generous woman. The woman did become pregnant, and about the same time the following year, she gave birth to a son, just as Elisha had said. So this first act of the story reveals the incredible generosity of God. And yet, in the second act of the story, we learn that one day a really tragic event happened. Verses 15 and 16 say this: the child grew, and one day he went out to his father, who was with the reapers, so out in the fields. He said to his father, "My head, my head." His father told a servant, "Carry him to his mother." We don't know how old the boy was. Old enough to go out into the fields, but light enough that he could be carried. And we don't know precisely what happened, but the inference is that he experienced pain in his head and he was carried into the house. And verse 20 is incredibly poignant. After the servant had lifted him up and carried him to his mother, the boy sat on her lap until noon, and then he died. I feel really moved as I read those words. This couple who thought they'd never have children had a son, and then he died in his mother's arms. I don't know about you, but my response is to cry out, the world isn't supposed to be like that. Children are not supposed to die before their parents. It just isn't right. About 25 years ago, we suffered a tragedy in our own family. Our niece became ill. She was in hospital in a coma for 8 months, and then she died. She was just 13 years old. And during her illness, we really prayed that God would heal her, but the answer we longed for just didn't come. Why would a loving, generous God allow that to happen? It's a very difficult question to answer, and my own experience is that attempts to offer a theological explanation can come across as trite and wholly inadequate, particularly for those who are suffering. We know that as Christians, we're not immune to illness and suffering. What we can say is that God is sovereign and his wisdom is beyond our understanding. And sometimes God doesn't reveal to us what he's doing. Sometimes his ways can seem to us puzzling and difficult to understand, and we may have to accept there are things we don't understand and we won't understand them this side of eternity. However, there is something here that we can learn that's really helpful from the example of this woman. She lays her son on the bed in Elisha's room in her house and she shuts the door. Remember that in that culture, people who died were normally buried the same day, and she didn't want that to happen. She spoke to her husband and said she was going to find Elisha, and her husband was actually no help at all. Maybe he didn't realise the boy was dead because he said to her, "Why go to Elisha today? It's not the new moon or the Sabbath." That's like saying, "Don't bother the vicar today. It's not Sunday." In the circumstances, it seems to me a bit of a crass thing to say, but the woman was undeterred. She takes a servant and donkey and hurries to find Elisha at Mount Carmel. Perhaps she knows the story about Elisha's predecessor, Elijah, who raised the son of the widow at Zarephath back to life. Elisha's servant Gehazi comes out to meet her and asks her if all is well. And she says, everything is all right, when actually everything was not all right. Isn't that just like us? Sometimes when people ask us how we are, we say, fine, everything's fine, when actually everything's not fine. It seems the woman didn't want to speak to Gehazi. She only wanted to speak to the main man, Elisha, because he was the man of God with the word of God and the power of God. Elisha recognizes her distress and he kneels, and she kneels at his feet and pours out her heart. She doesn't actually say that her son is dead, but it's implicit in what she does say. And Elisha understands. God had given her a son and then taken him away, and now she is brokenhearted. It raises the question, when we encounter difficulty in this life, what should we do? I would say the best thing we can do is to run to Jesus. Just as that woman ran to Elisha and knelt at his feet, the very best thing we can do when we're in distress is to run to Jesus and kneel at the foot of the cross. There we can pour out our deepest feelings with total honesty in prayer. He might not give us an answer, but he will give us himself, his presence. When a child hurts themselves, what they really want is a hug. They don't want an explanation of why the accident happened. And what Jesus longs for us to do is to come to him, to take us in his arms and comfort us. So if your heart is broken, go to Jesus in prayer. He may not give you an answer, but he'll give you his love. So in Act 2 of the story, we see that God's ways can be difficult to understand, but Jesus is always there for us. And then in Act 3, the son is brought back to life. Elisha sends Gehazi on ahead and tells him to lay his staff on the boy's face, which he does, but there's no response. The woman is determined to stay with Elisha, and she comes back with him to the house. Elisha goes into the room where the boy is laid. He shuts the door and prays to God, and he lays on the boy and uses touch. We might think this is all rather bizarre, but it would seem that Elisha was calling on God to give life to every part of the boy's body. And God answered that prayer by miraculously raising the dead boy to life. It shows us that God has extraordinary power. He can overcome even death. But we need to be careful in the way we interpret this story. It would be a mistake to conclude that all we need to do is to pray harder, to have greater faith, and all our problems will be solved. So there's a danger we'll conclude if a child is critically ill and we pray hard enough, the child will live. But sadly, it doesn't always happen like that. Do I believe that God has the power to do miraculous things today? Absolutely. But we have to understand that miracles were rare in Bible times, and miracles still happen today, but they are rare. The fact is that miracles in the Old Testament point us forward to Jesus. And there's actually a remarkable parallel between this story and the account of Jesus raising a widow's son in Luke 7. That miracle took place in Nain. And it's interesting to note that Nain was actually on the hill of Moreh, about 2 miles from Shunem. You might want to read that account sometime later today and think about the similarities between those two miracles. When people saw that miracle. They thought Jesus was a great prophet, like Elisha, the man of God with the word of God. What they didn't realise was that Jesus was actually the Son of God, and he embodies the word of God. Jesus had the power to bring a dead man back to life, but more than that, he conquered death entirely through his death and resurrection. And we need to remember that every miracle points forward to the day when Jesus will return to live with his people. There's a wonderful promise in Revelation 21, verse 4. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for the old order of things has passed away. So to conclude, this story tells us about the incredible generosity and the miraculous power of God. But it also reminds us that sometimes God's ways are really difficult to understand, and we may not ever understand fully some things in this life. But we can know that Jesus longs for us to run to him, to pour out our hearts to him in prayer at the foot of the cross. And ultimately, we can know that there'll be a day when there'll be no more death or crying or pain. We will be with Jesus, and it will be glorious. I'd also want to say that if you've been personally affected by any of the issues we've talked about this morning, and you feel you'd like to talk and pray with someone, if that's you, please do get in touch with me or Mick or Sarah. We'd love to listen and pray with you. Let's pray now. Gracious Lord Jesus, we lift to you all who are suffering, especially those who experience the ongoing sadness of not being able to have children or the heartbreak of losing a child. Help them to bring their pain to you at the foot of the cross. Give them the comfort of your presence and your love. Amen. We're going to sing again now. It's a song that speaks about the faithfulness of God and our dependence on him. Faithful One, so unchanging.
You are my rock in time of trouble. You lift me up when I fall down. Oh, through the storm, your love. You are my rock. Let us pray. Our loving Heavenly Father, thank you that we can bring our troubles, concerns, and requests to you, and that you hear us. We know you are a God who provides, a God of miracles, and nothing is beyond you. We marvel at your incredible generosity, so often undeserved on our part. We lift our praise to you for all things given and yet to be given to us. We lift our church and community to you, Lord. Thank you for the encouraging news regarding church finances as a result of the generous giving of the church family. We ask for continued protection for our church staff and leadership team as restrictions ease and the church doors are reopened. Please give wisdom for the key decisions needing to be made around planning for future services, pastoral courses, and the church's role within the community. Help the church and its family members to be faithful servants in the community, showing love, patience, and kindness as we seek to witness your glory. Amen.
Almighty God, help us to accept that sometimes you act in ways we are not able to understand. Strengthen our trust and faith in you so we know that in all things you work for the good of those who love you. In this time of great turbulence, guide the hands of our government leaders and those in positions of power. Let their decision-making be just, courageous, and for the good of the nation. We ask for your peace to pour out over the simmering tensions arising between our nation and China, and pray for a workable solution to trade negotiations as important deadlines approach. We praise you for the positive news that care home visits can resume in England, but continue to pray that caution remains in order to aid our recovery from this pandemic. We continue to celebrate the amazing work of NHS and care staff and all key workers. Let their work not be in vain, nor their efforts forgotten so quickly, Lord. Amen.
Gracious and merciful Father, we stand in awe at your extraordinary power. Thank you that we can witness your glory through your awesome power, as we heard through the restoration of life in today's Bible reading. Lord, let your power be at work in this broken world. Help our persecuted brothers and sisters to be strengthened by your presence, that they may continue to spread your good news to new hearts safely. We ask for your healing hand to bring an end to violence currently gripping America, Hong Kong, and the Middle East. In these times of tension, we pray for you to take control and fulfill your purpose for the lives of all your children, with no one disadvantaged due to their circumstances, and equality championed on all continents. Amen.
Abba Father, we know that you are for us and that your presence goes before us, whether we are weeping or rejoicing. You will never leave us to fend for ourselves, but you fight every battle alongside us. With this wonderful assurance guaranteed, we now take a few moments to lift up to you those who are in our hearts and in need of prayer. Lord, you are the giver of life and the healer of hearts. Philippians 4, verse 13 reminds us that we can do all things through him who strengthens us. We therefore ask that you revitalize us with the strength and energy to live for you in all that we do. For the glory of your name. Amen.
We're going to sing our final hymn now. We're going to sing the hymn, And Can It Be? And it's going to be a bit different this week. We are so grateful for Michael and David and for the many hours that they put in recording the songs that we watch, listen and join in with on a Sunday morning. And David has got some more people involved in this particular hymn. There will be many people that hopefully you'll recognise from Holy Trinity who have contributed to our next hymn. So let's really praise God for this final hymn and enjoy worshipping together.
Mystery, Lord, immortal time. Well, hi everyone. As we know, things are a little bit different at the moment, and that includes our summer holidays. Now, some of you may have had plans this summer that have been cancelled or had to be changed. And some of you may have been planning on going on a youth summer camp or a youth Christian conference or a Christian retreat, and that's been cancelled. Well, there's really good news, because Ventures, who run summer camps for those who are 8 to 18, are going online, and they're calling them virtual ventures. And it's going to be all the fun and the excitement and the silliness, the games and the teaching and the friendship of a normal venture, but online and from the comfort of your own sofa. Now, we're going to watch a video in just a minute which tells you more about this. But if you're interested in going on a venture, a virtual venture, then please do get in contact with me, and I will try and help you more and link you up with a venture. Well, let's watch that video now.
Hello and welcome to our home.
No venture for you this year then, Abs?
Nope. So what's going to happen instead?
We're going to squeeze all the fun, faith and friendship of ventures through the internet and into your homes, so you don't have to miss out. And we're going to call it Virtual Ventures.
Virtual Ventures. Okay, what will it be like?
Well, each one will be a bit different, but you'll be able to connect with friends and leaders. Some will have music and talks and entertainments. Bottom line is, a lot of laughs and the chance to explore Jesus further or for the first time.
That sounds great. Where will I find it?
You can watch some of them on YouTube, where you see everything on screen and get engaged in live chat and so on. Others will be on Zoom, where you can see each other and get involved in small group discussions. And also Instagram and platforms like that.
Can my friends come?
Well, that'd be brilliant. Just imagine your friends having the chance to see what a venture's really like before packing their suitcases and joining us on a residential next year.
Yep, I'm up for it.
Great, I'd be embarrassed if I couldn't persuade you to come along. Just make sure you register your interest online. And then plug in from your home. Jinx.
Jinx.
Hope we'll see you soon.
Thank you so much for joining us for our service this morning. I hope it has blessed you. If maybe it has brought up struggles, difficulties, or caused you to think about something that you would like to chat through and maybe pray with someone, please do contact myself or Mick or Sarah. We will be more than happy to chat through and pray with you over the telephone. Our details can be found through Church Suite, if you have access to that, or on the Holy Trinity website. Please do join us for our virtual coffee lounge after the service in 10 minutes. If you can, it will be great to see people there and chat further with you. As we close our service, let's close with a blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. Amen. Hope to see you again, same time, same place, next week. Goodbye.
above all the earth.